So it has been a very busy spring. I would love to share with you today some of the things that I have growing, and we'll start with my small square foot garden where I have four 4x4 beds. They're not full right now, but what I'd like to do is show you some of the plants which are growing. Most of them I actually planted in the fall, and I will show you which ones I have transplanted into the garden. In other words, I started them indoors, then I moved them into my garden, and then I'll show you the plants which I just put the seed right into the soil. I refer to that as direct sowing. And then I planted a new blueberry bush. I'll show that to you along with a couple of fruit trees. And then I'm growing some potatoes in containers. I'll show you a little trick so you can do that too. And then I have some beautiful kale and cabbage growing in one of my green stock vertical gardens. And then I want to show you one of the biggest mistakes that gardeners make. And I cannot stress enough how you've got to make sure you pay attention to this. So we'll look at that here in a minute too. And then I'm also making a new garden. And I came up with a great idea for a bean trellis. I'm also using this trellis for other things. So you might like that idea if you're looking for some way to support your plants. And we'll take a quick look at my herb container garden. And then I'll show you my indoor seed starting area, which I am using right now to chip my potatoes and also to start my peppers and my tomatoes. So let's go ahead and get started here with the square foot garden. In the front bed is some spinach, a little bed of spinach that I planted in the fall. I think I planted that in September, and it has grown all winter long. And then back here are some turnip greens, which are bolting. If you're new to gardening, that just means your plant is trying to go to seed and it will produce flowers in order to do so. I've been using those turnip greens there to feed my chickens, and they love them. And down here I have some arugula, which is up and growing. I just put that right into the soil. I didn't transplant it. I also put my peas right into the soil. However, I did put those in a little paper towel and a little wet paper towel in a Ziploc bag to sprout them first. So my peas are coming up, and I have some trellises beside them to help support them. Back in the corner is some bok choy, which I started indoors and transplanted it into the garden. Over here, I have this little archway, which I normally use for beans. I'm going to use it for my sugar snap peas today. I have to always put a little bit of string on this arch so that my beans can climb up it. So here are some more peas right down here. These are carrots, which I also planted in the fall, and they are doing real well. I'll just come out here and pull a few whenever I need a carrot or two for maybe a side dish for dinner. So those have been growing again since about September, and they've really taken off now that the spring temperatures are here. So you plant 16 per square foot, and you can just put those directly into your square foot garden soil. I don't know that other soils will germinate the carrots as well as the square foot garden soil mix. I just really like to use that mix. It makes my seeds come up so easily. And here's the little sage plant that I propagated last fall, and I did a video on that, and it's looking really good. I have a lot of Napa cabbage growing, which I transplanted into the soil. Here's some Savoy cabbage, which I transplanted into the garden. A few more peas there on the side, which are up and growing. And then right here is a potato plant, which got hit with the frost, and I have found from my experience that even if that green gets killed off a little bit with the frost, the potatoes still do fine. That's just my experience. And then right here is where I have sowed some seeds for beets and for lettuce. I just put those directly into my soil, and I put a little trellis on top because I've had some kind of animal digging around in my bed, and it messes up my seeds when they do that, of course. So the trellis helps keep them away. And here's a big patch of cilantro, which I sowed in the fall. Again, I think that was around in September, and it just really took off here in the spring, and I've been using it in so many things. It's so wonderful. My chives are doing great. They are just starting to bloom. And another little patch of spinach. And then I have shallots here in the middle, which I planted from a set. So it was a shallot, a small shallot bulb. So the cilantro I planted from seed. The chives I planted from a division. And I covered that in my chive video. And then, of course, the spinach. I always plant that by seed. And this is my new blueberry bush. I saw a tag on it which said that the blueberries were as big as cherries. And I've had some of those from the grocery store before, and they were so wonderful. So I picked up that plant to add to my little variety here. I have early season, mid season, and late season blueberry bushes growing, and they've been doing a wonderful job over the years. And I have a playlist if you'd like to see how I planted them and how they've been doing over the years. So we decided to add a couple of trees to our yard. We bought our house last year. We've been living here forever, but we finally decided to buy the house. So you'll notice that I'm doing a lot more things in the yard than I normally would. So we decided that a couple of apple trees were in order, and we picked some out. We went with the Yellow Delicious along with a Gala apple. You have to have two different varieties which will bloom at the same time, because some bloom early, some bloom mid season, some bloom late. So you have to make sure that the varieties that you choose are opening at the same time for cross-pollination, and you'll get apples. That's what you want, right? Here, the day that I'm actually doing the voiceover for this video, the apple trees are blooming. So I'm hoping that we did everything right. Okay, so let's head down to my container garden. And down here, I just have all of my very frost-sensitive plants like lemongrass, bay leaf plant, a couple of citrus trees. My Meyer lemon is looking really good, really nice. And now these are potatoes in containers, and I have just kept these up against my foundation, which is concrete, and it stays nice and warm there. You can see these have been totally unaffected by the frost that we had, unlike the other potato plant was hit pretty hard. Now these are what the seed potatoes looked like before I popped them in the soil. And this is the perfect chitting, really. You want it to be green and not too long. And so those are what I put into the containers, and I picked those up at the home improvement store. Okay, but I'll have another tip on potatoes here towards the end of the video. And I gave my lemongrass a haircut. As you can see, the galangal's looking great, along with the Kaffir lime tree. Have a lot of blooms on there, so hopefully I'll be getting some limes. And then here is the green stock. I've planted this completely with kale and a few cabbages, and all of this is for my chickens. I know I am spoiling them rotten, but yeah, and I appreciate those of you who have let me know that kale is a calcium binder. I don't really feed them much spinach anymore. They never really liked the spinach to begin with. They do love the kale, so I'm just making sure, you know, that they get enough of the oyster shell grit and that kind of thing. And then over here is another green stalk. I've already refreshed the soil, made sure I put some nice new compost in there with some fresh vermiculite and peat moss. And so these will be for my peppers that I grew last year. I'm going to do the same thing this year because it worked out so wonderfully. Now down here is where my old garden used to be. For those of you who are longtime subscribers, you know I had a nice little garden down here, but over the years and since we were renting, the trees just continued to grow. So that whole entire area was shaded. So since I'm moving the garden down there, I asked that my husband try to help me get this tree down. It was huge, so big. And so he got out there with a friend, and they took that tree down. And so he's got to burn all this here on the right that you see. And that's all of the wood that came from that one tree. It was a silver maple. So anyway, it is gone now. So I'm hoping that'll free up some sun for me. And that, my friends, brings me to the biggest mistake that new gardeners make. And that is underestimating the amount of sun they will need to grow summer vegetables. And as a matter of fact, most vegetables, they need at least 6 to 8 hours of sun every day. So for example, we moved into this house in 2010, and where I had my garden down here in this area, it was nice and sunny. It was a garden area that was used by the people who previously lived here. And then over about 5 years, the trees around the garden just continued to obviously get bigger and bigger, and then they casted more and more shade in the area. So being that I was a tenant, I decided to just move my square foot garden boxes up to a more sunny location, and I stopped gardening down here. But now that I want to expand my garden, we took down the big shade tree, which is a silver maple, and I have a lot more sunlight. So if you are a new gardener and you are looking for a place to have a garden, You need to be looking up in the sky and around your garden at those trees, because if you have trees, let's say in the early spring, that don't have leaves on them, and they're what are called deciduous trees because they lost their leaves in the fall, where they're going to fill in the summer. And when they fill in, you are probably going to lose a lot of the sunlight that you think you have right now in the spring. So make sure that you are looking at your sunlight hours. And if you own your house, you might need to take down some trees. So that's what we did. We took down the big shade tree. And the next thing I'm going to do, and I'll ask you guys for some help on this, is I'm trying to figure out an easy way to water the garden. We have a little creek that runs down at the base of our property. It feeds into the little pond there. I might try to use some of that creek water in some way. I'm not sure what I'm going to do because it's really so far from the house, and I really don't want to use our well water to water the garden. So when my garden was here before, it was so hard to keep the garden watered. And so anyway, if you have any ideas or suggestions, please leave them down below. I'm trying to think of some creative ways to water my garden. So this is a picture of my old garden, and you can see I used those arches to support my beans. And I just, you know, tied the string on those. And those you can get on Amazon. I think they're on Amazon Prime. I just ordered a couple more. But this year, I'm actually going to do something different. I was struggling trying to think of how I'm going to support my beans, because I want to grow a lot of beans this year. And then I realized that I had this greenhouse that my cover actually disintegrated on me. And so it's no longer useful as a greenhouse. This was a picture of my cover. I think I had it probably 2 or 3 months before the cover just fell apart. I kept it out in the hot summer sun, and I guess the UV light or something just fried the seams on the cover. So it did not last very long. So what I plan to do for my bean trellis is to use a little nylon trellis. This is used in the Square Foot Gardening book to make trellises. And so I remembered I had one of these. And so what I'm going to do is drape it across the greenhouse. I'll just put it over the top. You know, these nylon trellises are really nice if you don't have a way to support cucumbers or sugar snap peas. I guess there's about a 3-inch or 4-inch opening there, and you can just tie them to little poles, maybe little shepherd's hooks, and they offer great support for some of your vegetables. So since I'm going to convert this little greenhouse into a bean trellis, I ordered a bigger nylon trellis on Amazon, and it's 8 feet. Oh, I'm sorry, I think it's 5 feet by 15 feet, so that will be the perfect size to just drape it over this. And I like it too because I'll be able to walk through the middle in order to harvest my greasy beans. And these will be my, you know, my pole beans. And so I'm thinking that's going to work out really great. Now, what I'm using it for now is just to chip some more potatoes. I'm running out of space inside to chip my potatoes. So I just have them laying here on this little wire rack. And I expect them to be sprouting here any day. Now, here are some potatoes I picked up at the home improvement store in a little box. And when I got it home, I was so disappointed. You cannot grow potatoes that look like this. So I'm going to have to return all of those. And I'm kind of glad that I can actually return these, because when I went to my feed and seed store here locally to pick up some more coarse vermiculite, they had seed potatoes that were so much less expensive than these you get in the box. I think you get 6 to 8 of these in a box for like $4. I think I got 30 Yukon Gold seed potatoes for $3.50 at the seed store. So make sure you're checking out your seed store for things like coarse vermiculite and seed potatoes. And I'm just real impressed with all the things I'm finding there. So much less expensive than going to the local home improvement stores. So anyway, so that's where my new garden will be. I'll make sure to, you know, separate my beds the width of the greenhouse when I get that down there. So that'll be just the perfect little, I think, bean trellis. Okay, so up here in my container garden, this is where I have my peppers. These are the jalapeno peppers, and I have them hardening off. Actually, they're staying outside now all the time unless I am expecting a frost, and then I bring them indoors, of course, because they are very frost sensitive. And I have some chamomile growing over here, some scallions, some lemon thyme, tarragon, and I have a sad little Kaffir lime tree that I've been growing from seed. I think it died in my garage this past winter. And then rosemary, some more tarragon, can never have enough tarragon, some lavender. And then over here I have a couple of empty containers waiting on basil. And then the back I've tossed out some more scallion seeds. And then I have some lemongrass here, along with some parsley, more chamomile, along with a couple of mint plants. I divided my chives, so I have two chive plants. And then some more tarragon and another parsley plant. And then back here in the yard, of course, are my chickens, and I'm getting 18 eggs a week from them. So indoors, on the top of my indoor garden, I am chitting some potatoes. These are Kennebec, which are great storage potatoes. I'm just using this pretty much this time of year to get my seed started. I'm not growing lettuce in here. Then on my second shelf, I have some basil and fennel that I'm growing from seed. And then down here are my tomatoes, and I have some more peppers behind the tomatoes. These will be for my new garden, so I'm not in a hurry, but I'm growing a lot of these tomatoes this year. These are called ox hearts, and they are perfect for canning, for sauces, and for fresh eating. They weigh usually between 1 and 2 pounds, and I just so enjoyed growing these last year, so I'm growing a lot this year. Now, this is how I transplant my tomatoes. I just take them out of their little cell pack, and I'll pop them in a cup, which I have holes in. And y'all probably see me make my little holes with a little solder iron. And then I just put in some Mel's mix. I grow them in seed starting mix, but when I transplant them up to a bigger container, I go ahead and I start putting them in a good soil mix. And so that's the Mel's mix. Y'all know all about that. I've shown you how to make that. And then I'll put that in a cup, which does not have holes in it, with a little rock at the bottom so that the cup can drain. We want to make sure water is always draining away from your plants. Okay, so there you go. If you have any questions about things that I have shown you, please leave them down below the video. I'll be more than happy to help you. I hope you're all out there having fun digging in the dirt. And thanks for watching, and have a beautiful day.